God bless you, YouTube, Facebook, and today we have a special guest, the Embassy Church, for all the way from Atlanta. We thank God for everybody coming on today. Welcome to the Covenant Couples, about to say Divine Insight Ministries. Covenant Couples, we do this every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Central Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Welcome everybody. But today we are not just going to focus on couples. We understand that Apostle Harding and his church is with us today. So we're going to try to address a lot of these questions, not just for couples. And we always say that because we don't want you not to come on the ministry and not be exposed to this level of information if you're not married. But this is for singles. This is for couples. It's for if you've been married, divorced, you're in transition. It's really for the body of Christ, how to understand relationships. And so a lot of times we have brother relationships. You may have a Jonathan and a David relationship. You may have various relationships. And so for any type of relationship, brother, sometimes it's just how you deal with church. And we're going to talk about some things, dynamics in church. And so basically, but today is a Q&A. So welcome again. We actually do a couple of things. Can you go ahead and hit that share button? We know that Embassy Church, under the leadership of Apostle Dwayne Harding, great friend of mine, powerful man of God, just a powerful apostle and prophet. To me, he works in both arenas across the world. We know that his church is watching us on Zoom. And so we are aware that we have a Zoom group with us as well that may not be able to hit the share button. For those but are not who are watching it on Facebook, please hit that share button, share this on your page, invite some people out. And as always, we say God bless you and we thank you for all that you do. Good to see you, Brother Gregory. Good to see everybody. So we're going to do normally what we do. We start out in prayer and then we have questions that we may address. If there's any question tonight, tonight is open for Q&A. And so we're going to try to watch the comments for those who are able to make comments. If you have any questions tonight, we're going to try to address those. A lot of times we be a little lengthy concerning some questions. I'm going to try to shorten them up tonight so that we won't just be able to deal with one or two points, because I know there's so much that God wants to say to us about relationships. And a lot of times we don't get that time, because I'm also very concerned to not keep you all day in 2 hours of sessions. And so we're going to try to give more direct answers to deal with the questions today. But welcome everybody. This is Covenant Couples. This is session 17. So we have did 16 sessions already. If you have not heard it before, please go to YouTube and support our ministries on YouTube. We have videos available on you. We also have Divine Insight Ministry page, and we do a lot of teaching. But welcome everybody to Covenant Couples. Thank you for being a part of it. Good to see you, Sister Jan. Good to see everybody. We definitely miss you. Good to see everybody. The Olivers, God bless you. God bless everybody. So let's pray, and then we're going to go into this. But we do want to put out a special thank you to Apostle Dwayne Harding and his church, the Assembly. I messed up the name. It's a huge name. Okay, my thoughts are just flying everywhere because they didn't have time to get still time today. What is it? Embassy. Yeah. There it is. Okay, so thank you, and God bless you, and thank you for coming. Father, we thank you right now for what you're doing. Lord, give me what I need. You understand what I need to be able to hear from you. And so we thank you, Lord. Touch your people everywhere. We assign angels to our mind, north, east, south, and west. And God, we thank you for what you're doing and how you're doing it. And God, we see the manifestations of your blessing. Prepare us, God. I don't think that we're all the way ready for this manifestation. Help us to have the level of discipline that we need, so that you're trusting us with something. You're trusting us to give your people something, and we must be prepared. You said, be ready in season and out of season. And so we've heard you today. Touch your people. Holy Spirit, give us a word for your people. Wisdom, we're listening, and we thank you, Lord. And God, we give you praise and we give you honor. We allow the word to be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway. And we thank you for all that you're doing. And so have your way in this session. Allow us to say nothing out of our flesh, but only what you required for us to speak to the people. And so we declare that right now in the name of Jesus. Give us the atmosphere that's conducive, because without the atmosphere being right, there's not proper growth. And so we thank you, Lord. Forgive us for any sin we have committed, God. And we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So welcome again in with Embassy Church. Thank you, Pastor Dwayne Harding. I don't know where he is. Thank for everybody who's coming on and who is on. Go ahead and hit that share button. And please invite people out. If the Lord tells you to do a watch party, go ahead and do a watch party. So the first thing I want to talk about, like I said, I've been getting inboxes, different questions. And the first question that came up, it was on YouTube. The person was listening to one of our teachings. And the question was, when and how can a man trust his wife or trusts his fiance or in a relationship when the woman was unfaithful or untrustworthy? In other words, the question was, how do you gain trust back when it's destroyed? And since we have a church listening, I just don't want to tie that question to relationships. So the question would be, when trust is broken, and we're going to, I'm going to give a lot of dynamics today. When trust is broken from a husband and wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, pastor and minister, someone from the pulpit, someone from the pew, in leadership, when trust is broken, how do we address or how do we recover that level of trust? Now, this is a very broad question, and we can't give all the answers for tonight. Anytime we respond to this level of question, I want you to understand that at the end of the day, you have to go to the Holy Ghost, get in that Bible, and see what God is saying for you right in that situation. Because a lot of times there's a lot of dynamics that are not mentioned in the question. So a lot of times, this is where counsel times, they'll tell their truth. Okay, thank you for the connection. They'll tell their truth from their side, okay? They'll tell their truth from their side. And so sometimes you will addressing things. And so let me start out here. Say, for instance, there is a mistrust in leadership in a church, and people are having problem with the leader, the pastor, the apostle, the bishop, whatever the case. You have to be very careful when you address areas like this. And this is what I say to a lot of young ministers, because people sometimes are asking you questions out of pain, but they're not asking you questions out of a sincere heart for restoration. Sometimes we don't want restoration, we want justice. And so, especially when we feel like there's been an injustice, when it's been an injustice, especially in the church, this is why we hear a lot of people attacking the church. Now, we absolutely know that there is so many problems going along with the church, absolutely. So it is not a denial of issues that go on in the church. But it kind of remind me of Noah's ark, that when the animals was in the ark, I knew that it was smelling. They were doing what they do. But sometimes things don't smell good. Things don't look good, but it may be the only thing floating in your life. So to be very careful of not cursing your foundation or not cursing the pathway for a blessing to you because you're having problems. Sometimes we add problems to our marriage or to a covenant relationship or to our church because we're not honest with our intent or we're not honest with the sometimes the low frequency of our eyesight. And so we have to examine it all. But I want to deal basically with, can trust be restored? Whether it's in a marriage, whether it's in a relationship, whether it's in a church setting, whether it's with leadership, can trust be restored? And so I'm going to give a couple things that God revealed to me about when we have these type of pains or difficulties. I'm going to deal with it from a marriage point of view. I'm going to deal with it from church point of view. And then, my wife is going to speak and give us some wisdom and insight. Okay. Good to see everybody. God bless you. Please hit that share button. Let me start off from a church. Most of the time when there is a distrust in leadership in church, it is because most of the time the vision from either the leadership or the person that may not be in leadership is at two different levels. I remember being a part of a church and let's say I'm going to give a natural example. I share something with a leader. I'm just going to give some natural things today. We're going to really walk heavy today. I shared some things with my leader that was very personal about my marriage. Then the next thing I know, I come to church on a Sunday morning and the preacher is literally preaching at me or at my wife or at my kids about something that I revealed privately what was going on. It got exposed over the pulpit. This makes you feel like you can't trust leadership. this brings infidelity in because you allow a third party, which is called the congregation, mm-hmm. involved in that conversation. Now, the key to it is, and I'm going to say a lot of things today, the key to it is that if that leadership and that member who shared that information was a divine connection by God, the enemy wants that particular relationship to never be established. He never wants you to receive from that leader what you were supposed to receive from that leader. God, I feel the Holy Ghost. He never wanted that leader to experience things that you bring, watch this, to the leader. And so in those type of things, the devil is rejoicing because there's weakness somewhere. Now, this becomes a huge problem because a lot of times there are people in leadership that are not seasoned as they should be. That's why you don't let a novice teach, because it's not because he can't teach. It's not because he's not gifted, okay? You can have a gifted person, but the character has not been developed to handle issues without bleeding on the people. And a lot of times leadership bleed on people because they don't know how, watch this, to handle what is delivered to them in other people's personal lives. And this is a lot of times we experience pulpit bullying, that you begin to bully people from the pulpit. And this becomes a very, very, very dangerous thing, because now I don't trust leadership. Now I'm dealing with infidelity. My life is exposed. My situation is exposed. I'm embarrassed. But also it makes me come up with a concept that no leader in the church can be trusted. Right. When this happens, okay? So now it's not worthy. It's the same thing with women who came to the pastor for encouragement, for empowerment, but they were very weak, very broken, very fragile at the time. And the pastor took advantage of that moment and then ended up sleeping with the woman. And so now you have infidelity in the church, where you have fathers sleeping with daughters spiritually, spiritual incest, which breaks down, watch this, trust in leadership. There are many people today, God, I feel the Holy Ghost, yes, that God. Cannot move how they've been designed to move, cannot operate in the church because they don't trust leadership. They don't trust, watch this, they don't trust relationships. They don't trust men. They don't trust women. So back to the question. The question was that I'm married to a person, or I'm in a relationship, or I'm at a church, and because I've seen some unworthy behavior, how is the trust regained? Is it over? Does it mean that now I have to find a new father in the ministry? Do I have to find another wife? Is that grounds for divorce? Does it mean that I never trust my husband as a friend again? What happens? And so I love the question, because the question is needed. Because most of the time, we love to talk about what's wrong, but we don't talk about recovery. Most of the time, we don't have enough information to how to bring recovery in to marriages where someone was out of order or someone has broken the level of trust. Betrayal is one of the most hardest things to overcome. And the reason why betrayal is so difficult to overcome, God, I feel the moving of the Holy Spirit today, is because what betrayal does, it causes you not to trust. Hear this. Betrayal allows you, from an experience point of view, not from prophetic vision, but from an experience point of view, it allows you not to trust. So what happens is, it's not that you don't want to trust your pastor again. It's not that you don't want to trust leadership again. It's not that you don't want to trust church again, or your husband or your wife, but you don't trust. In other words, you don't trust the glue for the oneness to take place. And so what happens, I believe that when this happened, one of the recovery that we need when trust is gone, that somebody has to, watch this, somebody has to have a level of anointing on their lives. The Bible says that Jesus said in Luke chapter 4, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to heal the brokenhearted. Anytime trust is broken, it breaks your heart, because we trust people from our heart, okay? So we're going to get into those questions in a minute. But you need the anointing of God in your life that restores a broken heart, that allows you to reconnect. Watch this. To reconnect to that man of God. To reconnect to that woman of God. To reconnect to the reason why God put you together with that husband. To reconnect. And only the anointing can heal the brokenhearted, that the heart itself will allow, watch this, the love of God that's tied to purpose and ability. Most of the time, we remove ourselves from things because we feel like we don't have the ability to operate, but we don't understand the purpose. The purpose of the union has to be greater than the default that happened in the experience. The purpose of the connection has to mean more to you that we are designed to be one, to work together, that this is my husband, this is my wife, this is my ministry, this who God connect me to. The purpose of it has to be greater than the experience of the portrayal. See, the vision of it. And so if you see it that way, then the anointing will begin to bring healing, and healing will bring us to restoration. Most people don't desire restoration. They only desire a new beginning, which means they want to now learn how to operate in something and to function dysfunctionally because they've never been healed. But when you revisit the vision, the original reason why, this will say. Now, that's the first thing. The second thing, you got to say this. If we don't fight against flesh and blood, then who's really getting the glory out of our division? See, the devil is trying to break up every covenant relationship, whether it's pastor with another pastor, it's pastor with a member in the pew, whether it's husband, wife, whether it's Jonathan and David, whether it's Peter, James, and John, whether it's Naomi and Ruth. The devil is trying. So we got to see that when these things happen, the devil was threatened by the union. God, I feel the Holy Ghost. Yes, and he was threatened by the union. This is why, and I'm telling you from example, every church that I've ever been a part of, the devil always tried to come between me and at least one other person at that church, that together we were powerful. Yes. We were dynamic. We were apostles and prophets. So he tries to come in between because he's threatened at that level of power. He's threatened at that level of witness because you go out in twos. And so you must recognize this is not my wife's problem. This is not my husband's problem. This is a house divided against itself, cannot stand problem. And the enemy sees the power of it and tries to attack it. You got to defend your prophetic vision. You got to defend what God connected you to bring about the destiny in your life. Woo, God, I feel the Holy Ghost. And so the question, how do we restore? We ask for the anointing that heals the brokenhearted. How do we restore? We revisit the original purpose of the connection. Okay. Then how do we restore? We begin to repent. Anything that caused us to treat our brother or our sister or our husbands or our wives out of character that does not reflect, watch this, the unity of the Spirit. Here it is. You need Bible verse? Here it is, Ephesians chapter 4. Endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit. We have lost the endeavoring to stay together. Every joint supply. You have my medicine in your mouth. Yes, if God. I let this offense remove me from you, then I will never be able to get what God gave you to give to me. Okay? Yes. So it's very important. Mm-hmm. And if we become more purpose driven, we would fight for the union to stay because we understand the power of the union. Okay? So that's addressing church issues, addressing leadership. Now, there's many more, and we're going to talk about them. But I wanted to start there, that how do you recover trust? You need the anointing because trust is a heart issue, okay? And we're going to define our terms in a minute. Like, how do you define trust? Why do you feel like your trust was broken? Because a lot of times we have false expectations. You can feel like a person betrayed you because you have an expectation for them that was never biblically sound or God released. Okay? Very key. Okay? Very key. And so a lot of times the expectations that we have on the roles that we're supposed to play can cause that. But at the but another side, now stop here. Sometimes infidelity does show up in the house of God. Sometimes infidelity does show up in a marriage. Sometimes in many, there's many ways to cheat. Now, I don't want you to just think sexually. Right. There's many ways to cheat. There's many ways to hurt a person. There's many ways, because when we start dealing with what makes me say I trust you, I can trust you with conversation. I can trust you to listen to me. I can trust you with my secrets. And so that I can feel like I betray because you don't value my secrets. Everybody know. Okay. And I wrote down some things. I can feel like I trust you that you shouldn't have to hide things from me. And I come to find out that you hiding things from me that I didn't know. See, there's a lot of ways to create that. Okay. But at the end of the day, to answer the question, whenever you know that you are connected to the right person and betrayal comes in any form, you want trust to be restored. You want it to be recovered. And you must say, because it's a heart issue, we need the anointing to heal the heart that allows me to be willing to trust, willing to work out, willing to repair this, because the purpose of the connection. And this is what God is doing in this hour. For many people, God is reconnecting you to people that the devil got in the midst of the connection. I'm telling you right now, we need every joint. We need all key players on the team, back in the game. And the devil is trying. This is why marriage has been going through. This is why we pray for 8 hours for marriages. Marriages are being attacked. But biblical marriages are being attacked. And the devil doesn't want this union, even from this corona. God is connecting you to people that have medicine. Y'all have the strategies together. Y'all have the wisdom together. And the enemy don't want the beginning of the purpose of the union to move at another level. Okay? So I wanted to say that first. All right. Thank you for coming. Go ahead, sweetheart.
Amen. So first, I'm going to say good evening to everybody. It's always a blessing to, you know, to be here to fellowship with you all. And I'm just grateful every time that God gives me the opportunity, you know, and I really humbly accept the assignment. So I just want to just, you know, just say hello to everybody. I want to kind of like piggyback on, as you were talking, you mentioned about the two, you know, how the enemy is afraid of the pair as being the two.
Right.
So when you were saying it, and I heard the Spirit say that, that because of the tools, he's afraid because the tools, they turn into many, and then from many, they form into the cloud of witnesses.
Okay.
So see, this is the thing that he wants to do, is he wants to come in, he wants to distract. Not only does, first he comes in by a distraction, but then from a distraction, he wants to begin to tear down until he dissemble. He wants to dissemble everything that God has planned for that marriage, because I kind of think that from the very beginning, just knowing that it's that marriage is God ordained, that puts him on assignment.
Right.
It's not so much that he has to know what's going on per se in the marriage, but just knowing that marriage is covenant and God is covenant.
Right.
He's from the very beginning wanting to dissemble and just tear down everything that God has established for the union of marriage.
Right.
So because he's knowledgeable of those things.
Right.
So what he does is, His determination is to disassemble, dismantle. He wants to diss whatever God has for marriage. He wants to diss whatever, dismantle, disengage, disrupt, diss whatever. He wants to do that to marriage until he really resolves the marriage, until he gets rid of the marriage. You know, even when you were asking the question, how can a man trust to carry after she or he's been unworthy? And after being warned, I would say the only way that you could really restore something is to repent first. It's going to take repentance on both ends. Why? Because we're both guilty. Even though I may not have been the one that actually committed the act, my reactions, I have to repent for my reactions, because my reactions are not going to be in a godly manner.
Right.
My reactions are going to be far away from the things of God. My reaction, it doesn't mean that you're going to be hooping, hollering, cursing, all those things. But because of the initial shock of what goes on, your reaction is going to be totally opposite of who you were before you found out from that minute.
Right.
Because you're going to be shaken. At some point, in some places, you're going to be reshaken. So that's going to cause a turbulence right. in your emotions.
Right.
It's going to cause a turbulence in your covenant. It's going right. to cause a turbulence in your mindset, in everything pertaining to you as that person,
right.
because you're going to be shaken by that thing. So what we have to do is we have to repent. First of all, if we're going to go anywhere, we have to repent.
Right.
Then I said we have to rebuild. Rebuild means that we have to gather. First, we have to gather every material that's necessary.
Well, that's
in
good.
Order for us to begin to heal or begin to
wow.
go forward or whatever, we have to rebuild. So in building, we have to gather all the necessary materials.
Right.
That means that we're going to have to spend much time in prayer and much time in fasting mm. and much time and just listening and talking and conversing with one another. That is the building materials. Anything natural outside of this, the spiritual place,
right.
it can be, how would you say, it could be like a counterfeit. It could be counterfeit.
Right.
So what we need to do is really get all the necessary materials for rebuilding the relationship. Then from there, we have to restore. Restore, because what I'm saying is we have to go through all the restages. Why? Because we're trying to get back to a place. So what we have to do is restore. And in order for us to restore, it's going to take that necessary time for us to be able to hear, for us to listen, for us to pray, for us to hear God, for us to get assignments, for us to just really purge what we're really feeling with our whole emotional place of us. It has to be purged of all the contaminants that entered in, because infidelity is really like it's so venomous. It's like it hits like a rattlesnake, so it carries much venom. So what we have to do with that is we have to be restored back to it may not even be the original state, because we don't even want to go back to that place. When we go to being restored, we want to find that new place, that whole place in God. Because something along the process, maybe we weren't whole somewhere. Maybe we weren't unified somewhere. Maybe we weren't on one accord somewhere. So we, you know what we did? We lived our lives as usual. So we don't want to go back to that place that where we, you know, where it happened.
Right.
We want to go beyond that place. We want to be restored. So we want to go back to being the whole man, so that we can embrace from like a pure place,
right.
that we can embrace one another again from a place of certainty, from a place of, you know, from a holy place, from a place of love. And I mean, from not a place of pointing fingers and a place of accusations, but we want to be in a place where we're whole again, where God has touched us and God has restored us.
Right.
So we have to go to that place. We don't want to venue back into the things as normal, as usual,
right.
because there was something there waiting dormant for us that allowed us to get to that place. When things like this happen, it's just not a sudden thing. That means there was something dormant waiting in order to get in that place.
Mm-hmm.
That thing has been there all along, and it lets us know that we didn't have all of our necessary portals closed. There was something open somewhere allowed the enemy to get in. So what we were doing,
yeah.
we weren't on our post somewhere.
Right.
And we allowed the enemy to step in on us.
Right.
Because if we had,
right.
excuse me, if we had all openings covered and every avenue covered, then he couldn't have gotten in. So that lets us know, as a husband and a wife, because it's
right.
not one person's fault.
Right.
We were slipping somewhere, and
that's
we allowed
true.
The enemy to slip in on us. So we had an open portal somewhere. That's why we want to go back to a new place. We want to go back into God.
Right.
Afresh. We want to be restored to a place that God will begin to reveal where we are in him and follow the assignment that he has given unto
right,
us.
Right.
So once we're restored, then we can be reconstructed. Being reconstructed means simply just being what God and who God says that we are, because we have gone through the stages that will take us to the place where we can be restructured, because we can never be restructured if we have missing materials.
Right.
We're going to always be back to that place. It's going to lead us back to some unstable place. So in order for us to be totally reconstructed, we have to gather all the necessary materials. And once we're reconstructed, that means that we are in alignment with God's word first. That has to be first and foremost. We have to be in a place where we are in alignment. We have to acknowledge the covenant of what God and who God says we are, because we are a triune covenant. It's me, you, and God.
Right.
So we are a triune covenant. We have to know how to be covenant the way God addresses it, the way God desires it, the way God recommends it. Everything has to have God fingerprint on it. If we're going to be in that place where we are totally reconstructed, we cannot bypass any of the instructions.
Right.
We cannot bypass the manual, and we cannot remove, take away, or add anything to the blueprint, because God has constructed this thing. So this is what's going to take us to the place of being reconstructed in marriage. It's going to take us some time. We cannot put a date on it.
Right.
We cannot put a time on it, because actually, like I said once before, the clock cannot have a time limit on it. It can't even have a facing. All we know is that we're moving forward in a place where God is taking us. We can't put a rush to it. We can't get frustrated in it. We will, but we have to know how to gather ourselves, gather our emotions. And that's the importance of praying one for another, because when I see him weak, then I have to be that strength for that moment. I have to begin to go to God. I have to begin to, give him the strength, allow my strength to pull him over, because we are married. And what we do is we don't really take the time to get all the essentials of marriage. We don't know everything there is to marriage.
And to the church, and God is the church, listen to, not just marriage.
And even in just a relationship, okay. And I'm just saying, we have to be in the place where we can gather all the necessary and required essentials and materials to be what God wants us to do. Even in the church, that applies to the leadership too.
Right.
Even in the church, and we say the church, and when we say the church, let me tell you, the first thing we envision when we say the church, we see a building. And that is so far from the truth. We are the church. So when all these things are transpiring, we have to understand that the building has nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
The building has nothing to do with it. From the head to the last member of the body, there has to be instruction given, and it starts from the head. And with the head being in order, then the body's going to be in order. And as you were saying, even from being in the position of the pulpit, that place is supposed to be an honorable place, but there is a lot of danger that comes from that place also. And knowing that, like you said, you've had things that was preached privately that were privately spoken. I've had the same thing done too. But I'll tell you what, many times we'll get that offense, that spirit of offense.
Right.
And even though it may have, it comes from the leader, but I'm going to tell you the best way to heal by that is to follow the instruction of God. Because you know why? When those things happen to us in the church, God is allowing those things to happen many a times that he can be proven in our lives,
right,
and that God can show us really what he has on the inside of us.
Right.
And God takes those very things to be able to begin to minister to our spirit. But we have to have a willingness to hear God. We have to have a willingness to sit and listen to the instruction, because you know why? God will, first of all, he's going to automatically give you that repentant heart. Then he's going to teach you, how to lift up that one that offended you, to pray for that one, forgive that one. Because even in that, there are guidelines that we have to follow in that. And we do get hurt in ministry, yes. But I'm telling you, God does not want us to stay in that place. Why? Because that place will take us to a place where we just become just overtaken, and next thing you know, we're complacent. Why? Because that what we call church hurt, that church hurt will take you to a spot.
Right.
And being in that place, I'm telling you, as you stay in that place, the only thing that grows in that place is voices. Voices. There are so many voices connected to church hurt.
Right.
Because those voices don't want you to ever get back to your place in God. So what it's going to do, it's going to not only, it's going to seem like it's tearing that person down, but actually it's so, the enemy is so cunning that he's tearing you down. You're the one that's really being torn down. Right. And he has, if you've given him that attention, then he's going to maneuver on your consciousness. He's going to maneuver on your mindset to make it look like it's that other person. But yet, in secret, he's tearing you down. He's destroying you. Because after all, he's after you. He's after the seed that you possess on the inside of you. So what he's going to do is he wants to become that stronghold in your mind that you, you know, that you become, yet your bitterness become rooted. And that thing keeps you from moving forward in God. That thing, it keeps you being rooted. I mean, having a root of bitterness, it's like, it's detrimental. It's close to death because you die to the spiritual part of you.
Right.
And it disconnects you.
Right.
It really disconnects you from right. the things of God. It kills your desires. It kills so much that part of you that's supposed to come forth. And what it wants to do, it wants to stagnate it until he aborts it.
Right.
And that's the part that he wants to do
right.
from the ministry point.
Yes. And hit the share button, share this on your page. I want to address a couple of questions because I don't want people to be confused. I see sister, a brother, I think it's bigger. One of the persons says, you confused, isn't it Wednesday? Are we supposed to talk about couples? And so I want you to know that we have a special guest today, a church from Atlanta that's with us. So we are including not just marriage answers or solutions, but we also including the marriage of church. So we don't want you to be confused. But the reason why she's addressing the church as well is because we have a church along with us. Mm-hmm. This is their Bible study time. So instead of having Bible study, they are with us in covenant couples. So we're including the marriage solution that ties to spiritual marriage, whether it's in leadership in church, as well as couples and relationships. Okay. So I don't want you to be confused on that. Thank right. you for stating it in your comment while my wife was talking. Another thing, another comment that was given up was saying that a lot of times it's not the devil, it's self-destruction. And I do believe that we can self-sabotage things, but I believe that every spirit that fights against unity is the devil, even though the person may have some mindsets about themselves. In other words, mm-hmm. we have to have enough strategy and love for people that we see what they are in captivity to. You see, because a lot of times what is going on, this is why I'm trying to make it clear. We use the blame game. I don't want the blame game, okay? And so even when it comes to talking about church, because even though we are the church, sometimes we say that with a distance or a we have feelings about the building. And so what happens is we're hiding our feelings about the experience in the building behind we are the church. Regardless of where we assemble, we need a building to assemble there, or we need a place. Even right now, we are on streams, but I'm in a building, so we're having church. So I don't want to use truth to attack certain things, especially when we have a church here today. I don't want the people of the church believe, okay, his wife said, it ain't about that. Here we sitting in church. So or we are church. So I don't want to do that. But we're talking about relationships that experience distrust, whether it is in a church setting, a pulpit and the congregation, whether it's husband, whether it's wife, whether it's boyfriend, girlfriend, whether it's Jonathan and David, whether it's Naomi and Ruth, regardless of the covenant, when distrust come in, we want to apply the principles. And my wife says, we have to be rebuilt. We have to be restored. We have to be reconstruct. And so those are very key things in bringing about recovery to a union that God put together. Okay. So I want to see that. So another Bible verse to be able to address, because I always want to keep us in the Bible, because I don't want people to say we gave our opinion and didn't give scriptures. And so when God speaks to Adam and Eve, before they have a physical form, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, he said to them, be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth. And you'll notice that he said, be fruitful. But he said unto them, The commandment in the word was given unto them. God is a God of family. He's a God of unity. He's a God of oneness. The Lord's Prayer, not the disciples' prayer, but the Lord's Prayer is make them one as we are one. And so the enemy fights against any union that brings about the plan of God, any union, regardless of what it is. And so he tries to bring distrust so that we will not work together. You'll notice when Adam began to eat of the forbidden fruit, their eyes were open. And they sold fig leaves together. Very key. And you'll notice that Adam began to have the blame game. Whenever these things happen, you begin to have the blame game. The wife you gave me, the husband you gave me, the pastor, the church I go to, okay? My kids, all those things. And so those things are purposely coming from the devil to divide us as a people or to divide us as a nation. And so that's the key. But when you realize what God said to us, what God said to us, and he said to them, you got to know when you're giving a word, there's someone else that's connected to that word to bring a manifestation. The devil don't even show up until the third chapter because he knows that even though the plan was given to them, Adam is by himself right now. And so he cannot bring to pass that manifestation of that word until the womb shows up. Until the woman shows up. And so the enemy knows what connection and who needs who to go to your next level. The whole purpose of a wife is to help you go to the next level. She's your helpmate. And so in any form of connection, whether it's marriages, your wife is your wife for a reason. He hoping that you never see the reason why she's there. It's the same thing as the church. The church is a her. And so that particular mother, this is why sometimes we get offended when people talk about church because we feel like we're talking about our mother. Because most of us was birthed out of this. Mm-hmm. This would introduce us to purpose and to God and to worship and things like that. But we got to understand the enemy fights against the union. He never wants you to know, regardless of where it is, what denomination it is, there are people that God has assigned based upon destiny, the union of these people together. Every joint supply, and so that you will never trust that thing that you are designed to be connected to so that you can grow. And that's the whole thing. And so I think we need recovery from church hurt, marriage hurt, infidelity in relationships, brotherly hurt, sisterly hurt, daughter and mother hurt. Even Malachi chapter 4, I pray that the hearts of the children be turned back to the hearts of the father and the hearts of the father be turned back to the children, because there is a division, and the devil is master at making us have real justification of why we shouldn't trust our wives anymore. We're not looking at the original purpose of what God said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth. We're looking at she hurt me. We're not looking at that God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, and subdue. That he hurt me, he cheated on me, or the pastor misused me, or the church abused me, or they exposed me, or all these things. And then what happens is you focus so much on the problem that you never focus on the promise. You got to start focusing on the promise. God. So that's real key. So I wanted to say that. And then my wife brought up a very good point when she said, rebuilding, you got to know the material. Whenever there is any offense, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. We have to ask ourselves, out of that emotional bondage or emotional, we've been wounded emotionally from any form of offense, any form of betrayal. We got to ask ourselves, what was stole from me during my offense? See, because again, I don't have the right material to rebuild, that I don't have what I need. There's a lot of people right now, you can't be effective in this marriage. You've been married, you've been divorced. You're not effective in this relationship. You're not effective in the ministry you're in now because there was things robbed out of you from the last relationship and you never recovered all the things that were stolen. And so now you may know your purpose, but you may not have the ingredients to do your purpose. You can know you a cake, but if the ingredients that make a cake has been stolen from you, you can never produce what you know you are. And so many times, this is why this particular question is very important, because we got to get restored. You were supposed to bring something to the table, but something was stolen from you from that last church hurt, that last relationship. And so now you can't love this man the way you need to love him, because love was stolen from you. You don't trust yourself to love at that level anymore. You don't trust yourself to forgive at that level. So now this new husband has to dance through hoops. He got to dance today right, tomorrow right, the next right. He got 7 days he got to do exactly right, or if not, you'll hold back again. You'll hold back. You don't trust, because the last time I loved at that level, I got hurt. The last time I served at that level, I got hurt. So now you don't serve. You join the church, but you ain't all the way in. You in the relationship, but your forgiveness ain't all the way there. Your love is not all the way there. Your excitement is not all the way there. Your commitment is not all the way there. Why? Because the last thing you experienced created a trust that was never recovered, and now you don't have the material to even rebuild. You may have repented, but you didn't recover. When David came home from battle and he was out fighting for God, he come home and his kids was captured and his family was captured. And he said, Lord, he was discouraged. He had encouraged himself. He said, Lord, what should I do? I'm out here taking care of your business and my home is falling apart. And many times your house fall apart. And God says, go and recover all. We need people that said, I'm going to recover. Before I met you, I was loving. I was smiling. I had laughter. I enjoyed life. But ever since this thing happened to me, I don't smile like I used to. I'm not happy like I used to. I can't enjoy private time. Private time. I'm thinking what you doing, where you at, who you with, all this stuff, because something wasn't recovered. The material that I need to enjoy this new place, the material that I need. And so now your wife is suffering because you're not the man she married, because you got wounded somewhere in the marriage and you have never recovered back to that man or back to what my wife said, even farther, because where you going, it needs even more. See what I'm saying? And so you can't even go back to where you were, because where you were, watch this, is not capable of fulfilling what's coming. You got to have an overflow. You got to keep growing in God. See? Very key. Very key. And so the next point I want to deal with, I mean, she brought up so many powerful points. You got to deal with the material and wanting to restore to wholeness, okay? That's what repentance, because a lot of times we say repentance as if, just say I'm sorry. Saying I'm sorry is not repentance. Repentance is a change of mindset that brings about a change of behavior. That is essential, because if you're not thinking any different about relationships, you're not going to act any different in a relationship. If you don't think any different about men, then you're not going to treat men differently. If you don't think differently to a woman. So your mindset has everything to do with repentance. Okay? Repentance. So I want to deal with that. Okay. So the next thing I want to talk about, and we're going to stay on that point because I feel that's what God is. And matter of fact, I'm praying, because there's a lot of people. What? Let's just throw the question out there. I really feel this, because I got a lot of calls this week about people who's been church hurt. And we know that normally this is covenant couple and we spend a majority of our time, but we're not going to hold that down to just male and female relationships or husband and wife when there's other problems in the house of God that needs to be dealt with, that needs the same principle that a husband and wife practice. It needs to be practiced in the church. Okay. So I want to ask this question, and then my wife is going to speak again. What in your life has wounded you that you can't get back in the game regardless of the relationship? Are you honest about where you don't trust? Because we can come up with all the Bible answers, but the truth of the matter is, do you want to be made whole? Do you really want to recover regardless of where it is? Okay? And so I'm praying that this wakes you up, that said, God, I need you to reconstruct. I need some godly sorrow concerning the, some way how I think. Because let me tell you something. If you don't change your way of thinking, you will never find a right man. It'll always be something wrong with him, why you can't love him, be submissive, be in line, be committed, be faithful. You'll always find something to justify your pain. Same thing with a man. If you don't truly change the way you think, you're always finding something wrong with her. And my wife brought this up. What was missing that the portrayal was even able to come in? See, we don't want to be honest that we come in with messed up stuff. We come in with the wrong mentality. We come in with the wrong heart. We come in with the wrong expectations. And then when it don't work, it just justify anyway, because we rather point at everybody else rather than look at what's wrong with me. What's wrong with me that I'm always seeing something in someone else, but I never see it in myself? Or what's lacking in my life? What ingredients do I don't have, that I don't care how much I try this, I'm not going to get it. But I'd rather say it's you than to say I lack love to build what we're trying to build. I lack security. I am insecure. Uh-oh. What if you're married to a man who's insecure and he'll always feel like you're not trustworthy, but really it ain't his trustworthy. It's your insecurity that creates an imagination that you see what you believe you saw. You'll see what you believe you saw and you'll bring it into your imagination. That's what the devil does. That's why you got to pull out every thought and imagination and exalt itself. That's even in church. That's in relationships. That's in fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, regardless of what it is. Okay, so here it is. I put here in my notes, trust, man, our time is almost up. Trust can mean different things to different people. In romantic relationships, trust can mean this. So I put down, trust can mean that I feel committed to the relationship. And so when we're dealing with relationships, let's ask ourselves, do I feel committed? Okay, I feel committed to the relationship, or I feel committed to my partner. When I don't receive the same level of commitment that I believe that I'm giving you, now I feel betrayed because I put my total trust in you. I trusted you with my feelings. I trusted you, watch this, with integrity. I commit myself to you. I took away the blinders, or I put up the blinders, or I took down the walls. I made myself vulnerable. And now you took advantage of that. Okay. We got to talk about those type of things when we're dealing with that. So I want to talk about when you are committed to a person and you feel like your level of commitment is not their level of commitment. And can that bring about a distrust? Because this is the thing. My level of commitment could bleed into control. Mm-hmm. And I can believe that I'm just a committed person. Well, really, I'm an insecure person that needs this level of commitment to hide my insecurities. Uh-oh. Are you talking to me? Now, let's go a little deeper. Are you committed to the person, or are you committed to the vision that the person plays a part in? What's more important, the vision or the people in the vision? Because if I tie myself into you and not the vision that God put us together, I could make an idol out of you and call it commitment. What if I begin to worship you, and what happens is God allowed things to happen in the relationship or at the church because I had you on the pedestal that I should have never put you at that level. Mm-hmm. Do you know most of the time when we have trust issues, it's because we have an idol issue, that you are trusting an idol greater than you're trusting God. Okay? Let's talk about that. Go ahead, baby.
Yes. That's good. Oh, that portion right there.
Okay.
Of having, like, say you like that person, wanting that person to be on your level of commitment, right?
Right.
That creates so much dysfunction in a relationship.
Right.
Because when it first, as you were saying it, I'm telling you, I was writing it down.
Right.
At first, it causes a rebellion.
Okay.
It causes you to rebel against the truth of what your marriage is, what your marriage is supposed to represent,
right,
and the purpose of your marriage.
Right.
It causes you to rebel against those things because why? You're trying, like you said, you're trying to build this idol,
mm-hmm,
and make this person an idol for your own glory.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Mm-hmm.
So that causes that. Then right. Right. What is going
to
do?
For your own glory. I want
right.
you to hear that.
For your own okay. glory. Okay. And then come what on. It's going to cause too? It's going to cause rejection because you're rejecting the things of God.
Ooh.
You're rejecting. I mean, it's like you're laying on that rejection button. You're rejecting the truth of covenant. You're rejecting the truth of what God says. You're rejecting everything that is in alignment with what God said marriage is supposed to be. So you're rejecting it. That means that I'm totally going against it. There's
right.
no other way to put it.
Right.
I'm rejecting it.
Right.
So then from me rejecting it, it causes a relocation. That relocation means that I'm living in my own mindset. I'm living from my place. Everything becomes mine. You have really relocated because it causes you to separate yourself
right.
from the truth of what you're supposed to be becoming with this person.
Right.
So that causes you to relocate. You may be in the same house, but right here, I've relocated.
Right.
I'm living in a different place up here.
Right.
So now what I'm going to do is I'm building my own temple up here.
Right.
I'm building my own empire up here. So that means that now I'm just in the place with her, living physically, but emotionally and everything else. I live here now because I've relocated Ooh. Within myself. Because I'm not merging with that other person. So that's basically what you've done. You've
right.
relocated. You've left the marriage. Because now you're one again. I mean, you're division. You're two again.
Right.
That causes division. So what you're doing is you're going back to the mindset of being two. When you're automatically one. So that
right.
makes everything that you're doing illegal.
Right.
You're living from an illegal standpoint.
Right.
And what that does is it creates an emotional distress on the other person.
Right.
It creates how do you say it? A separation.
Right.
And it causes that other person to be burdened with things that she'll never or he'll never even have answers for. Why? Because all of your answers lie inside of you. This person is striving to become and to be what I'm supposed to be for this marriage.
Right.
But yet there's going to create a void because the other part of me is missing.
Right.
That other person is really not even seeing you as two. That other person is still seeing you as the other half of myself. So half of me is missing. So what it's going to do is going to cause the part of me that I am to try to find the other part of me wherever you are. And undoubtedly that person will never find it because it's been locked out because you've relocated. You'll
okay.
never find that person.
Okay.
You understand
yeah.
that?
Yeah,
you'll
got,
never find
yeah,
that
yeah.
person.
I was lost for a minute. Okay. I
yeah.
Got you.
You'll never
okay.
find that person because that person has created his or her own world.
Okay. Okay.
See, so that,
okay.
that really puts stress on a marriage
okay.
because now I'm trying to find out where you are. You know, you're here.
Right.
I see you.
Right. Right. But you relocated. I got,
yes. But
I got you
up here, you've
right.
relocated.
Right. Right. And that happens. That definitely happens when you feel like you've been betrayed, because a lot of people will divorce you and never sign the papers, but they've been left the marriage. There are
oh,
people
God, yes.
who leave the church, but never left the church. You've been left the church. And so a lot of times that happened because we relocated in our mind. That's a very,
yes.
Very powerful point. Somebody put on there a question. I think it was Sister Jan. When do you begin, when this happened in a marriage, when do you begin after you repent, trying to rebuild, recover, all those things? When do you begin to minister one another in love? I think the beginning of coming together again, when there's been a division, the timing, and my wife put it like the clock, and I think that's true. This is what I would say about the clock. You can't rush people in healing, absolutely.
Right.
But you can't give people a clock to also sin. And so in that, having a clock without a face on it, that only means for healing. That don't mean you can keep going out sleeping on me and I'm giving you time to get it. No, that don't mean that. So I want you to hear that too, because a lot of people, they'll tell you that you got to give me time to heal, but you still doing things that create wounds.
Ooh.
You can't keep practicing what's causing the problem and then use the time for healing to practice. In other words, we can't give you a license to keep offending the relationship. Right. And so the clock that doesn't have a face on it is for healing, not to rush your healing time. But it's not time to keep falling. Right. Okay? That's the very key.
Yeah.
Because what happens is, even though we're trying to restore, I keep digging a deeper wound by your behavior.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's why it's very key that you desire. Because when you desire to be whole, you change the way you were thinking so you can change what you was doing. If you never have real repentance, you still practicing falling, but you want me to give you time for healing. When you have never began to heal. And this is when people say, how much time do I need to give you? You ain't got over it in 5 years. Well, the reason why they haven't got over it in 5 years, because they keep doing it within the 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
See, you got to let the healing begin. Timing is for you to stop and allow the healing to begin. And so back to the question that Jan asked, when do love start? When you know the purpose and the vision of the union, whether it's church, whether it's leadership, whether it's marriage, whether it's brotherhood, when you begin to heal, the call for the purpose will come back. It will begin to grow, the desire for it. And the purpose will lead y'all back together. The purpose will lead y'all back together. I understand my purpose in this marriage. And so regardless, sometimes, and me and my wife have very few arguments, very few. But when we do, one of the things that has helped us, that we may not agree right now, but I know my purpose in this marriage. So I'm still going to cut the grass. I'm still going to do what I'm called to do. And as she sees that my attitude hasn't changed as a husband, sometimes that brings us back together because we're still in the marriage. Mm-hmm. We're just not in agreement right now. We waiting on God to give us some answers. She may need some time to herself. I need some time to herself. But I'm still doing my purpose for this marriage.
Yes.
It don't stop me from functioning. And so when I do that, the purpose brings us back together. Next thing she know, I'm outside cutting the grass. When I come in, I notice that she cooked dinner. And so now I'm saying to myself, okay, we're getting past this because it didn't stop dinner from being cooked.
Right.
It didn't stop the grass from being cut. And then she may say, come on, baby. Well, when I hear baby, okay, I'm back to baby. Because when we was arguing, I wasn't baby. See what I'm saying? Real talk. And vice versa. And so when it brings us back together. So when is it time to minister when you've been broken? The purpose and the vision that you keep being faithful to. Now, that's even in church.
Yes,
when would it heal? When you still showed up for Bible study. When you came back to leadership class, when you still got back on the drums in the organ, then we understand that you have telling me that your commitment to the vision is bigger than our personal issues that we may not agree upon. This is what we call solidarity. We need solidarity that we may not always have the agreement, but we know that we got to get this done. Souls still need to be saved. People still need to be delivered.
Mm-hmm.
Praise and worship still must go on. The marriage cannot, the house can't be nasty because we argue. And so the purpose will begin to minister to us, and then we'll begin to minister one another by doing the vision and the purpose, okay? So I'm hoping that answers your question, Sister Jan, because we need to know that, because a lot of people, you have let somebody else step in because your time, watch this, for healing would have took place if you'd have kept doing what you're called to do. But you took that time to heal and abandoned everything. And this is a major thing that the devil do. I'm speaking to somebody. Watch when you've been hurt and the devil make you quit everything. I'm telling you, it'll lead you to suicide.
Yes,
it'll lead you to depression because, watch this, because you ain't playing the drums, you ain't playing the piano, you ain't preaching, you ain't writing books, you ain't drawing, you ain't doing other things you love to do, you ain't listening to worship, you ain't helping kids, you ain't going to the daycare, you ain't going to the homeless, you ain't helping the people at the nursing home, you ain't praying for people. It'll have you quit everything. You won't speak no more, and the devil wants to isolate you from everything that can bring you back to healing. Do you know one of the best ways to bring people back to healing is to put them into what they do? This is why they'll tell you come back to work and we'll put you back on light duty, because light duty will put you in the environment of what you love, and your love for it will begin to give you the nourishment that you need to get back. Woo! Okay, very key. So I wanted to talk about that. Okay,
Let me add this.
Come on, sweetheart.
Because even that nourishment, which you're speaking of, it's really called brokenness. Because right. In order for us to get back into that place, there has to be brokenness that has to take place. And that means from both angles, from both sides.
Okay.
Because what it does is it's got to break. When we say break brokenness, we got to take it from the natural side. That means to break the things off that's been weighing on you. That breaks those things off. That's the natural brokenness. The spiritual brokenness is when I can resubmit my place, myself back to the place in God where I was, that place that God had me in. I've resubmitted myself back to that place.
Right.
So that's the spiritual brokenness.
Right.
But it has to take place from both sides, because we can't leave one in the wilderness
right.
and the other one is here.
Right.
So we have to go together. And in order to go together, that means all the things that have to be broken off of us. That
right.
means the stubbornness, the rejection, the pointing fingers,
right.
the acute,
right.
the accusations, the all the other stuff, the bitterness, the all of this. Those things need to be broken off of us. The distrust. I mean, every form of everything that caused us to split has to be broken off of us.
Right.
And what we have to do is find the solution, which means going and find the core of that thing
right.
and uproot it. Because
right.
if we don't, we're still leaving seeds for that thing to blossom again.
Right.
So what we have to do, we have to get it from the root. And it may take us some time.
Right.
But if we just be diligent in getting back together as we were in breaking apart, we'll find it. Because that thing that so drove us to going separate ways, that spiritual part of us can bring us back together and draw us back together. And that way we'll be on the be on the same path now, because we have the same expectations and
right.
we have the oneness
right.
again. And this is what we're going to do. We know that now there's an enemy in our camp. We're going to go find
there
this thing. We're going to detect
there
him.
We go.
And I say we're right. going to detect where this thing is, and we're going to find
right.
it. And we're going to uproot it
right.
and we're going to get rid of it. And then what we're going to do is go back to the first place I mentioned of closing every portal.
Right.
We have to make sure all of those portals are closed.
Right.
So that's the part
right.
of the reconstruction that
right.
we have to do. Because actually, it doesn't matter who did what. We're both responsible because of the oneness of who we are.
Right.
That means like that. There's that scale again.
That's
you
right.
know what? Because you did it don't mean you have to fix it all. And I'm going to stay down here while you up there trying to figure it out. Nope. Because you know what? See, the one that it was that
yeah.
not so much it was done to you, because it was done to God. But
right.
the one that suffered from it,
right.
that's the one going to carry the burden
right.
of that thing. I'm
right.
telling you.
Right.
And by that thing falling up on you, you take on the weight. So here's what you're going to do. You're going to intercede like nothing going.
That's right.
Until God breaks that thing off of you.
Right.
But in the process, I can't leave him. Despite of how angry, how mad, how frustrated, how
right.
hurt,
right.
I still got to go to God for him.
Right.
Because the obligation still rests upon me.
Endeavor to keep the
yes.
unity of the Spirit.
Yes, God.
The key to handling any breakage in a divine covenant
yes.
is to understand that the assignment is given to them. Is given to us.
Yes, Lord.
Even when you pray, the Bible says when you pray, that seems like it's talking about you. It says, say
yes,
our
God.
Father. Don't even go to God as you're going to him by yourself. Say our Father. And we know that all things, see what I'm saying? He said unto the brethren, see, it is a unity, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. It's the oneness of us all. See what I'm saying? Even when you make your calling and election sure, you have to do it. Here we go in Ephesians chapter 4, meekness, lowly, forbearing one another in love.
Yes,
see what I'm saying? Yes. See, you have to make up your mind before you get married, before you join a church, before you join a ministry.
Yes.
I was led here, called here to fulfill an assignment. I'm not going to leave, watch this, until my assignment is over. If my assignment, like marriage, is an eternal assignment, then I'm always going to be working on it, because it is an eternal assignment. You got to know that going in. See, if you don't know that going in, when the storms happen, you're going to quit. A lot of times the problem is you go into it saying, if you cheat on me, I'm done. You know what? If the pastor say this, I'm done. If they do this, I'm done. You went in with a done already. See what I'm saying? You already created space for the devil to put furniture in to justify what you're trying to create in your own mind. Can't make space. You know, the Bible says don't give place to the devil. My grandfather say if you give him space, he'll make a place. And many times what happened in the marriage, you gave space for the enemy to make a place. Mm-hmm. In your mind, you gave space for it.
Yeah.
See? And so you got to know this is eternal. And so if who God put together, let no man put asunder. That's whatever it is. We got to fight for our brother. We got to become our brother keeper. We got to fight for the destiny and the connection. We're not doing it. It's too easy to focus on what happened to me versus what was supposed to happen through me in that situation. What was God trying to get through you in that connection? What is God trying to reveal to you? The power of that unity in that marriage. He wants you to see everything is wrong so you never see what's already right. He wants you to see what's missing so you won't know what's already there.
Right.
See, very key.
Yeah.
So we passed an hour. I didn't want to go too long. I don't know if Pastor Harding has his church pass an hour of teaching. We thank God for everybody coming on. I'm going to give out one more point and have my wife close it out and give prayer. But thank for Embassy Georgia. They joined us today. So we talked a little bit more about church settings than just covenant because we have a church along with us with Apostle Dwayne Harding. So we thank God for that. But we also thank God for Divine Insight Ministries and all those who are connected to us who joins us every Wednesday. We thank God for you.
Amen.
And we've been talking about basically how to handle a relationship when one of the partners do something that is not trustworthy and they bring infidelity or they bring trust issues in. Is there a recovery plan? And I love that because we talk more about what's wrong versus how to recover. How do we recover? When the doctor tell me that so-and-so has cancer, I want to know, is it recovery? When you come out of surgery, there's a recovery room. We need to have more recovery rooms because there are too many great people that are sitting on the sideline because they've been wounded and we're losing the game because we never cared about recovering the people that God assigned. The greatest apostles, prophets, and evangelists, pastors, teachers, I hate to say it, they are not in the church. They are not connected to a ministry. They're the greatest husbands are not connected to a wife. There are so many powerful women out there, but they are not connected to a husband because the enemy has caused something to happen in their experiences,
yes,
things that they have yielded themselves to, or captivities the devil has put them in. And because of that, the real women who should be speaking is not speaking. And so now we got all these people on the sideline who really has the right strategy. They can tell us how to win the game, but they've been so wounded and so hurt that they'd rather tell somebody how to run than to get the ball and show us how to run. We need somebody that's willing to show me what this look like. We need marriages that stay together and show me what a divine marriage look like. That's why me and my wife come on. We don't have everything perfect, but we want to show that it's attainable. And regardless of how wounded we are, the vision and the purpose is more important than my personal disagreements or personal insecurities.
Amen.
God can heal that. Matter of fact, do you know most of the time the person you can connect you to carry the very thing you are complaining about? If you're a husband, you know why the devil came after your wife? Because he wants you to see what's wrong with your wife so you won't see what's right with her to get what you need. He blinds you by the problem. You got to have your eyes open by the promise. Why is she with me? Why is he there? Most of the time when you have a problem, most of the people that don't like you need you. Most of the people that don't like you need you. When somebody don't like you and don't know you, it's because you carry their medicine and the devil got to make sure you never meet David, Jonathan.
Yes,
you
God.
Never meet him. Barnabas, Paul, you never meet Barnabas because there's some Barnabas in your life. There's some key makers in your life that God wants you to be connected to and the devil uses all, he'll use my weakness so that you won't pull from my strength. He will magnify my problems so you will never see the magnitude of my promises. You'll never see them. You'll never see them. You'll never see the possibilities. And so we praying for all those who've been wounded in marriages. We're not taking this lightly. You are a powerful man of God. Your wife is a powerful woman of God. But the devil is using things that y'all two never be fruitful. Multiply, replenish, subdue. What's in the house that a professional thief called the devil wants to rob from you? Oh, I said before, a professional thief never robs a bag lady. So if you keep being attacked by the devil, then what's in your house that he see that you don't see? See, we don't see what's in the house. We don't see what's in the house. We so busy talking about the bishops ain't right, the apostles ain't right, black man ain't right, white man ain't right. We're missing what's in the house. What's in the house? Why you been attacked since the day you've been born? Why the devil been trying to make nobody in your family see you? Why you think you the black sheep of the family? Why are you being so ignored? You carry something that's beneficial to the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. That's why you can't know people by the flesh. Stop knowing pastors, leaders, your wife, your husband by the flesh. Because yes, it will always deceive you. You got to know them by the spirit, okay? Amen. So let me see here. Let me look at this.
I want to say this to you.
Come on, baby.
You know, many times when we marry, you know, we get married. Some of us get married young. Some of us get married, you know, middle age. Some of us get married older. But the thing is that we don't have the keys. When we go into marriage, we haven't gathered keys. That's why so much is missing in the marriages, because we are, you know, we go through the dating process, we go through the courtship, we go through all the hoops and all the good things of having the relationship. Then once we get married, you know, then we go into the place of we use the word marriage, but we haven't changed. We haven't matured.
Right, right.
We lack maturity. Right, right. We lack keys.
And that's
which
key.
Yes.
Because marriage is fully mature.
So what we do is we're still in the same place of before we got married.
Right.
But because we're married now,
right,
the only thing we're adding is that word is marriage.
Right.
We haven't changed. We haven't matured into marriage.
Right.
We haven't really embraced the definition of marriage. We don't know because we don't have the right keys.
Mm-hmm.
So we can't unlock anything as we proceed forward.
Mm-hmm.
We don't even know that keys exist.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is then this too, I have to say this too, you know, much of it has to do with the ministry, the church, because that's the importance of having a counseling before marriage.
Right.
First of all, it's supposed to be from the house that you learn some things.
Right.
Then through counseling,
right,
your eyes are open into the spiritual parts that you're going to have.
Right.
And those are the essentials for marriage.
Right.
And then once you do become married, then you have to be allowed yourself to put all those tools to use. You can't get the tools and don't use them.
Right.
So what we do is we marry from an immature place.
Right.
But yet we want the mature parts of marriage when we don't even know how to define them.
Right. Right.
We don't know how to define what real marriage is.
Right.
Because first of all, sometimes some of us we've been raised in single homes.
Right.
We've never had the opportunity
right.
to see what marriage really looks like.
Right. Right.
So that's one strike.
Right.
Then we go by other marriages by the ways of what we see. And we see broken marriages in other parts of the family. We see broken marriages on television. So that's as close as we will get to experiencing, you know, living,
right.
you know,
right.
seeing marriage for what it really is.
Right.
But as children, we weren't as fortunate as some to have both parents living in the house.
Right.
Not only just living in the house, but displaying what real marriage is.
Right.
We didn't have mom and dad taking us to church and we learning of God. And then when we home, daddy is the priest at home and daddy is pouring into us the spiritual things that we needed. And mama is nurturing what daddy
right.
says,
right.
what daddy pronounces and what daddy prophesied over us. Mama didn't nurture. We didn't have that.
Right.
So you know what? We missed it. We missed many of us missed the pronouncement of who we are in
right.
God.
Right.
And that really is a true essence of us missing the real portion of marriage, the spiritual side of marriage, the
right.
maturity of marriage, because we didn't get the opportunity
right.
to be a part of any of it.
Right.
So then as from the church, you know, being in the ministry, do we hold the church totally responsible? No, because we have a responsibility of our own to learn of God, that the word is for all of us. So as we begin to get in God, then God will begin to, you know, give us the essentials of marriage. God will begin to pour upon us the blessings of marriage and
right.
opening our understanding and our eyes to marriage.
Right.
But we have to focus our eyes on something. And if we don't focus our eyes on the word, then we'll never It'll never, our spirits in part of us in marriage will never be illuminated. Why? Because it's going to stay in a dark place because the word, we haven't given the word an opportunity to shine the light on it. See, it doesn't mean because we didn't live it don't mean that we're denied it. That right. does not mean that.
Right.
So from the spiritual side, God can still give us the measure that we need to become who he said we are in him.
Right.
So we have to understand that too. And I wanted to add that because right. I know some people, you know, ponder with that, even though we're saying all of this and people are saying, well, how would I know if I was never there?
Right.
Or how would I know if, you know, how I'm supposed to know these things exist if I never saw my daddy do this stuff or
right.
whatever.
Right.
Or I really, the real side of where I live,
right.
I don't see anybody like
right.
that.
Right.
You know, so that has to be addressed as well.
Right. And the key to it is like we have some challenges because we're growing. My grandfather was born 1902. He got saved 1916. So his teaching on marriage was based upon the era in which he was in. So a lot of clarity. Because the real teaching of a marriage is really when you're single.
Yeah.
Do you understand that singlehood is training for marriage? That's really what it is. When you're single, do you know your first husband is God? And so if
right.
you're faithful to God in your singlehood,
right.
when God brings you to your husband, you'll know how to love him as a husband because you love God as the husbandman.
Right.
He's the husbandman.
Yeah.
But again, it's our clarity. A lot of times we don't word it that way. And so you don't understand. You think you're mm-hmm. single as if you're not married. But the Bible says man who finds a wife, again, she's married first to God.
Right.
See? And so if the woman is married first to God and she loved God in season, out of season, she worshiped God, she praised God,
yes.
she submitted to God in hard times and great times, when she gets with her husband, she'll love the God in him like she's been loving the God outside of him because
right.
it's still the God in him that she's in love with.
Right.
She's in love with him because he carries the God character of the God she was marrying or she was already married to before she met the man.
Right.
So all she
yeah.
do is meeting God in a man now. She yes. already know the God part. Now she knowing it from an earthly perspective.
Mm-hmm.
When she was single, she was married. Same thing with a man. We are married to God first. We are the church, so we are the female. We are the woman. We're married to him first. And so when I'm married to him, watch this, and I watch how God loved me as a single man, now I know how to give love to my wife because the same example that God gave love to me, that's how I'll love my wife. So I can love my wife as Christ loved the church because before
yeah.
I got with her as a single man, I was married to God as a single woman. See, and so what happened? Marriage is only the timing of maturity of
right.
what you did singly. Now you do it collectively. That's all it is. It is the. It
yes,
is. It, that's why it's for
yes,
the mature. Yes. That's a timing. It's time for you now. That what you been? How you been walking with me, Adam? Walk with your wife now. Matter of fact, leave mother and father and cleave unto your wife.
Yes.
Your timing has come to show on earth with your mate the very thing you already been showing with me.
Yes.
And so if you want to know the examples of how to be married, how faithful are you to with God when you're single?
Mm-hmm.
See? And how do you know you're ready for marriage? When your singlehood has been maximized. We don't teach our young people to maximize singlehood. If you pray all day when you single, when you get married, you know how to travail in your marriage.
Yes, Lord.
See? Because you've already travailed. And now you have a right to share. Watch this. Because when you were single, you couldn't be intimate with nobody but God. Now he allows you to have spiritual intimacy and physical intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
Now sexuality is allowed. See, now you can enjoy both worlds. That's what it is. It brings the heaven and earth together. But if you know how to serve God as a single person, you won't have no problem loving your wife as a married man. You won't have
yeah.
no problem being submissive to your husband because you're submissive to love. If love cover you, you have no problem coming underneath it. See what I'm saying? But most of the time, we're looking for a physical marriage from human beings
yeah.
to be our example when your example has to come from God. If you don't know how to be faithful to God, you can never be faithful to me. If you don't know how to love, if you don't know the love of God, you will never love your wife as Christ loved the church because you don't have no example. Your daddy can never show you the love that God shows. Your example has to be God. So really, singlehood prepares us for marriage. See what I'm saying? When God is the object of our life.
Amen.
See?
Yeah.
How did I learn how to love my wife? Because God showed me how much he loved me. Did God pull back his love when I mess up? So how can I pull back my love when she mess up? Uh-oh. Because I got to do with her how God dealt with me.
Yes.
Woo! See? But we have to maximize singlehood. If you really use your time being single with God, you will be the best wife in the world for your husband. And he'll say, my God, baby, I came over work and you was praying for me. You said, I always intercede even before I met you. I'm a prayer warrior. Uh-oh. I'm a prayer warrior. That's what you met me in that place. You met me. So now I'm not offended when you speaking in tongues because I met you speaking in tongues. Uh-oh, I'm not offended when you following God because I met you following God. So now our vision becomes one. I know why you connected me because God ain't interrupting his relationship to take me somewhere opposite that he never took me. Why are you giving me something my daddy never gave me? Uh-oh, when you go to a marriage, you know what the seminar is, or you know what the ordinance is. Who give this bride away? It is tradition that the father does. Many times the reason why it don't work because we eloped. The father never presented Eve to you. Uh-oh. The father has to release the marriage. Adam didn't ask for a wife. God says his timing has come. It's not good for him to be alone. That was the timing. How can he be alone when all he had was you? You're not enough. It's not time for him to be alone at this level. He has to be all one at another level. His timing has come. See? See? Eve was presented to Adam, but he pulled her out of his flesh. See? So when Adam was spending time with God, so was Eve. Uh-oh, because Eve was in there. Uh-oh, so the singlehood prepares you for the marriage.
Yes.
That's the real example. Not a couple that you think got it all together and don't know the truth. Mm-hmm. See, if you use human beings, that whatever it is, they don't tell you all that they're going through. Now, when you run into a problem you never seen them have, you don't have an answer for it because you can't have an example for everything. The only real example is Christ. Okay.
Amen.
Good to see you, Lee. So let's end there, baby. Go ahead and end this in prayer. Thank you for coming. We appreciate everybody, the church, all those who are part of the ministry, those who are visiting for the first time. We have a Divine Insight Ministries. We're on every day, Monday through Friday at 12 noon Central Standard Time, 1 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. If you've never been a part, please visit us. Come see us. We have many videos on YouTube, about 700 and something videos on YouTube. You can do that. We also have a public profile page as well. Robert Jenkins has a public profile. You can be a friend. I've now been able to open up my friends, so I'm not just limited for 5,000. Please visit our page. My wife is Cassandra Jenkins. If you need counseling, if you need a word, you need any type of instructions, and you feel like God has laid us on your heart to help you in that area, please inbox us. We are open for counseling sessions. We do counseling sessions. We also have a ministry, Divine Insight Ministry. We have a website, www.divineinsightministries.net. Okay. So we on YouTube, we on Instagram, we on Monday through Friday, 12 noon Central Standard Time, 1 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. So again, we thank Apostle Dwayne Harden and his church embassy. We thank you for all those who are part, who was linked on through Zoom. We thank you for that. Divine Insight Ministries, we love you, everybody. And if God lays on your heart to be a blessing to us in the financial expression, we have PayPal available. We have Cash App available. And whatever God lays on your heart, whatever God purpose in your heart, you sow that and watch what God do. And we already know you already blessed because you're able to give. And so we thank God for that. We love you. My wife is going to end in prayer. Thank you for coming. And we'll see you tomorrow. Okay, same time, same place.
Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we bless you on tonight, God. Father, right now we enter your gates with thanksgiving and come before your courts with praise. And Lord, we enter through the blood of Jesus. And God, we just thank you, Lord. Father, we just bless you for the words that were spoken on tonight, God.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you, Lord, that every word that was spoken, God, Lord, that it has illuminated your people on tonight, God.
Hallelujah.
Father, we ask you, Lord, to bless them, Lord, like never before, God. We ask you, Lord, Jesus. To just invade their understanding and their wisdom on tonight, God, in the name of Jesus, God. Lord, touch them in every area, Lord God, that needs to be reserved, that needs to be revised, Lord God, that needs to be restructured, Lord God, every place, Lord God, that needs to be healed on tonight, God, in the name of Jesus. Father, we just thank you, Lord, whether it be marriage, whether it be church, God, any definition of hurt, God, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your blood has arrested it on tonight, God, in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, we just bless you, Lord. Father, we give you the glory. glory, God. Even for right now, God, in the situations that we are living in right now, God, we thank you for our calmness, for our peace, Lord, that only you can provide, God.
Yes, Lord.
We even thank you, Lord, for the marriages, Lord, God. We speak growth right now in the name of Jesus, God. Even as we are in the houses together, Lord, Father, we thank you for growth, Lord. We thank you for unity of the marriages beginning to grow like never before, God. In the name of Jesus, God, we thank you, Lord, for even illuminating them things, Lord, concerning you for their marriage, God. In the name of Jesus. And God, we bless you right now, God. Lord, we give you the glory. Father, we give you the praise. We lift up every household that's present on the line on tonight, God. We, Lord, even lift up their families, God. We thank you, Lord, for everything that was heard on tonight, God, that it will be growth and guidance to their marriages on tonight, God. In the name of Jesus, God, and we bless you, Lord. Father, we give you all the glory on tonight. Father, we give you the praise, and we receive it all by faith in the mighty name of Jesus. And we all say amen and bless God. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you, God bless you. Please, if you didn't hit that share button, share this on your page.
Thank you, God.
And we'll see you tomorrow at 12 noon. Walk in God's favor.
Amen.